talking about Philia, which is a brotherly love, and our talk is going to be about how to build authentic friendships. So I'm going to introduce you to our speaker, and we have an interesting introduction today. He's going to tell us two truths and a lie, and you have to guess which one's the lie. So pay attention. He's been a priest for 45 years, but he's only been in a parish for 3 years. And he was the chaplain for the New York Giants. Yes.
I'm hoping the last year's a lie.
Okay, we're not leaving it like that. How many think I'm a priest 45 years? How many think I was in a parish only 3 years? How many think I was chaplain for the New York Giants? Alright, I'm not a priest 45 years. Yeah. My name is Father Vinny Fortunato. I'm a Capuchin Franciscan. I live in Wilmington, Delaware. I'm a priest 36 years. I have been doing a lot of different things over those 36 years. For 20 years, I did formation work. Formation work is, it's kind of like the job that nobody wants. It's training guys as they're coming through. And I first started off teaching in a high school seminary. They said, just do this for like a year or two. And then 20 years later, but I did all different things. Novice director, pastoral director, those are different religious terms for guys going through religious life. Then I got elected provincial. It's kind of like, provincial is like a president of a group. So our province goes from New Jersey to Florida. So I got elected provincial, which meant that I had to go visit the friars around the whole Eastern Seaboard there. I would go down to a place in Florida, in Tampa, in February during spring training. See the friars for 2 days, and then 5 days go to the Yankees spring training. Some fringe benefits. And then I did some development work. I taught at Seton Hall University, the seminary at Seton Hall, taught spiritual direction there. Then became a pastor in Hoboken, New Jersey. Great place. Hoboken. It's one square mile, and it's young people heaven. Four parishes in this one square mile, and I averaged 50 weddings a year, so you can see it was great. And then my provincial came to me, and when the provincial asks you to do something, it's like the bishop asking you to do something. I wasn't provincial at this time. I was finished. And he said, Vinny, I want you to go do preaching full time. I said, to who? He said, oh, you'll find stuff. I was doing a lot of stuff with priests at the time. He said, I really think you need to do that. I said, you know, Nick, it's a nice idea, but I don't know. I said, this poor parish has had lousy pastors. Don't quote that. For 10 years, and they're just coming alive. He said, yeah, you're probably right. So then he came to me a month later. He said, Vinny, I don't know. I'm praying, and it just keeps coming back to me that God really wants you to do this. And I said, isn't that funny? Because I'm praying, and God's saying, don't do it. But I made a suggestion. If he put this guy in as pastor, I'm comfortable, and he was going to do that anyway. So that was my sign, a confirmation that this is what I'm supposed to do. So I do parish missions, priest retreats, I teach spiritual direction. I've been teaching priests spiritual direction for about 22 years. I'll talk a little bit about that in the talk. I grew up in Long Island, that's why I have this weird accent. I, I shouldn't say I have a wonderful accent. But I realized that when I said talk. I live in Wilmington, Delaware, so that's why it's only 2 hours. Came down, I'll go back tonight. It was Sunday after leave for Chicago. Just got in from Florida last night, two nights ago, so. Okay. I want to talk tonight about how to build authentic friendships. Now, I am not going to tell you any secrets or anything new. You don't have to write anything down. All I'm probably going to do is just give a, you know, like sometimes when you have a word for something, you say, ah, now I know what that's like. And so sometimes it's just hearing something that makes a difference in your head. So I'm not an expert on friendships. You can ask some of my friends, they'll tell you I'm not that good at it anyway. So, and I'm working it off of C.S. Lewis's book, The Four Loves. This is an old version of it, read it in 1984. You weren't born yet, I already read the book. And looked at it again last week. And C.S. Lewis talks about, he uses the word friendship, where the Greeks would have used philia, philios, brotherly. And so he doesn't like to go that route. So he talks about different levels of relationships. He's also talking about two things, need love and want love. And real quickly, need love is what we all have. We all need to be loved. Need love, want love, gift love. Gift love is the love that he believes nobody really, really can do except God. And because it's totally pure gift with nothing in return. And that's very hard for us to comprehend. What's that like? So I'm going to talk tonight a little bit about friendships and go back and forth to some of the stuff of C.S. Lewis and hopefully give you some time for questions in the end. My God, time's flying already. What is authentic friendship? What's authentic? It's a very scary word because it's something that means it has an origin. It's real, unquestionable evidence. It requires time. It's not common. That's what authentic is. It's dangerous to try to put that to friendship because then we get stuck in, our friendship is. It just is timeless. Our friendship is not common. And that can set us up for a lot of failure because I make the friendship greater than what it really is. The key thing about authentic friendships is it stands the test of time. So you might be friends with someone now, and it feels like this is forever, you know? With the BFFs, best friend forever. Dangerous terminology. So in the context of friendship has legs. What do I mean by that? Friendship has legs, so it moves around. It has all kinds of dynamic movements, and it's not stagnant. It goes back and forth. So I like to look at things in a certain way. So if I say around me is a circle, and in that circle there's other circles. So my outer circle is people that I'm kind of friendly with, but, you know, if I don't see them ever again, I'm not going to cry over it. But they're friends. Then that circle gets a little closer, and it's like these people I get a little closer with, I kind of spend time with them, I look forward to seeing them. Then there's another circle, and that's the circle that these are the people I'm in touch with maybe every day. I'm constantly close to them. And then there's another small circle, and that is the circle that some people get into. And some people might be one or two or five. Now it depends, every person's different. So if you think of that circle, like I have 10 close friends. Well, your circle, that inner circle is pretty big. And so there are more people, or this can happen the other way, is, geez, this person here thinks I'm a really close friend to them. I am in their inner circle, but I don't want them in mine. And it's like, they're a pain in the neck. I don't want that. So when we look at friendship, and it is dynamic, and it's different for different people. And hopefully that's gonna come through, because one of the dangers is I can put friends in a category where everybody is equal. Worst thing a person can say is, you are my best friend. My best friend is the guy we've been friends with since we were 13. My best friend always introduces me as, this is my best male friend. This is my best friend. Except when there's other of his best friends around. Then he goes, this is my best friend because he was best man at my wedding. And so that's a category. But what is it really? We have a number of people who might be very, very close to us that I look at as my best friend. It's so dangerous to put people in levels. It's a very male-oriented thing. I don't want to put guys down, but it's a male-oriented thing that many women have picked up. We put categories. Categories. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You're my fifth best friend. Try harder. I need to get you up higher in my category. So what does C.S. Lewis talk about? The first thing he talks about is companionship. And that friendship comes from companionship. Companionship is what a lot of people call friendships. But he looks at companionship as something that, you know, you do with other people, that there's a certain common thing. But that's about it. You know how you know this? You know, how many of you graduated from high school last year? It's past. So when you guys went home at around Thanksgiving time or something and got together with some of your high school friends, how was that? Was it fun? Because I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to get less and less and less. In high school, it was like, you know, this is great. I can't wait till we get back together again after our first break from college. We're going to all come back and, well, you can't go to a bar, but... I did. When I was a kid, drinking age was 18, so we did go to bars. And it didn't take long for me to realize, I have nothing in common with these people. I can't believe that I really wanted to spend a lot of time with them. So everybody gets together the first time, you start to talk about things that are common, but when you don't have a common thing anymore, it's hard to hold it together. And that's what he's talking about when he says companionship. It's not that that's bad. It's just that it has a certain place. Friends from high school, you know, that's always a danger. So companionship is really like a link to friendship. And companionships and friendships do not have to last for life. I say that that's really C.S. Lewis's thing. That they don't have to last forever. In the moment, we think they do. And that's one of the dangers, is I equate everything on the same level. It's all the same level. So what does C.S. Lewis say? This is from page 96. In this book, I'm not sure if you have the book or if it's been revised, but I'm sure it has. He says this: friendship arises out of companionship when two or more of the companions discover that they have in common some insight or interest, or even taste what the others do not share, and which, till that moment, each believed to be his own unique treasure or burden. So, let's see. Okay. I play guitar. When I was in college, I used to play. We played a lot of Zeppelin stuff. So I come across somebody of your age, and they say they got a Led Zeppelin shirt on. I'm going, what? It's a what? Where'd you get that shirt? Well, man, kid's 19. He's always been a Zeppelin fan. Well, there's a common interest here. But really? What album you got? And we start to talk. The conversation. We got an interest. Well, that's about it. That's it. That's all we got in common. And we might sit and listen to Zeppelin for hours and drive everybody who doesn't like Zeppelin crazy. And they say, what are you guys doing? Oh, just listen to this guitar work here. Are you kidding? Listen to this thing. Doesn't sound like anything I want to listen to. Okay, they're not in our group. And that's what C.S. Lewis says. This common interest, it might be one thing, starts as a companionship and moves to a friendship. Now I'm gonna take this now and push it a little further. Friendship, outside of companionship, so we're moved into the friendship part, is a form of love. It's a form of love. It's one of the levels of the three loves that the Greeks used, the philia, which is brotherly love. And that's Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Who's from Philadelphia? It's the city of brotherly love. It's not brotherly, and there ain't no love. Philadelphia fans are the worst fans of the world. Philadelphia fans are so bad that when the Philadelphia Phillies have a ring out, the fans go to the airport to boo bad landings. But it's a nice city. They do have good cheesesteaks. It's like I grew up in Long Island, and when you're from New York, you just think that there's really nothing else better. But I lived in Jersey for 13 years, and I listened to these Jersey people tell me how great Jersey is. And I said, the only great thing about Jersey is the view of New York. But so anyway, philia, or brotherly love, is the first level of love. So you have philia, eros, which the word erotic comes from that. How many know what erotic is? Don't be afraid to raise your hand. Erotic is, to put it nicely, it's kind of like sexual love, all right? But that's where it comes from. And then there's agape, which is the ultimate. That's the sharing of the heart. Now, eros, which is erotic love, can also be a sharing of the heart, but not to the level of agape. So for C.S. Lewis, this philia, or friendship love, is the second level. This first level is companionship, or affection. It's not gender concerned, even though the word philia is feminine. It's not gender concerned. It crosses over all lines. So you can have a love for a person of the same sex, and a love for a person of the opposite sex, and it's a deep friendship. With no intention of going any further than just the fact that you're friends. My friend, Cherry, who I'm his best friend, because I was his best man at his wedding, he's a psychologist, and he's the director of the autism program at Montclair State University, and so he's just a brilliant psychologist, but he and I, we have just this loving relationship, and sometimes we're talking on the phone, and I'll say, Vinny, I love you. I love you so much. I said, Jerry, hope nobody's listening in. Jerry, I'm a priest. I could be arrested. But we're not afraid to say it. We're not afraid. Why? Because that friendship is deep. And it's different than my other friend who I grew up with since I was 5, who lives in Burke, Virginia. And Mark and I have been friends since we were 5. We don't see each other that much anymore just because of the distance. And, you know, somebody said, it is so great you guys have been together since, I'm 65, so we celebrate our 60th anniversary of being friends this year. We took the, not like his, well, it really was, he and his wife and him had their 30th wedding anniversary, and the family was on the Potomac cruise thing, but then they ended up celebrating our 60th anniversary of friendship. And I said, you know what, Mom, you know what's so great? You and I have done so many things together since we were five. We did some things together that only you and I know what we did. Because those bars were long nights on Long Island. Anyway, I said, you know what's wonderful? We really don't know an awful lot about each other, anything more than what we knew when we were 12. And you know what? That's okay. I have a close friendship with him, but I wouldn't share an awful lot of my stuff with him, and he wouldn't share it with me. He would get bored. And Mark is Jewish. He knows more about the Catholic faith than most Catholics do because of our friendship. We talked about it a lot. Okay. Friendships are born from companionship. C.S. Lewis says, friendship is born when one person says to another, what? You too? I thought that no one but myself thought of that. It's a great line that when we discover somebody else has a connection, a little bit more than companionship. It's a sharing of common interests. You know, it can be a number of people. So it doesn't have to be just two people. It's a number of people. But the dynamic shifts when one person moves from that relationship. So let's say three people who are close friends, one of them dies. The other two don't say, okay, now it's you and I, man. No, something's missing. Because that friendship was three. Some friendships are like five. My friend Jerry, his wife, talks to her five friends that she went through grammar school, high school with every day. Every day she talks to them. These six girls, they'll connect every day. And then she says to Jerry, you know, you and Vinny are so close. You see each other like once every 3 months. You don't really talk on the phone. And so Jerry calls you and says, hey, Vinny, I think we got to go to the movies. I says, all right, why? He says, I don't know. Kelly's getting suspicious that you and I really aren't friends. So we gotta do something that makes it look like friends. What's the depth of this level? It's like any level of love. And the bottom line of every level of love is a common thing. I want to be known. I want to be known. Every one of us has that desire that I want somebody to know what's going on inside here. So we seek common interests unconsciously and consciously. The danger of a lot of this, and I'm not trying to criticize social media, but that's a big danger, is, you know what? You don't really get to know me from my text. So I'm spiritual director to this wonderful woman who's about 26 years old. And so she was talking about, you know, she wants to meet this guy, to meet somebody, all right? So she meets this guy, and she says to me, and he's a nice guy. I said, oh, okay, that's great. I said, is he nice to you? She goes, yeah. Is he interested in you? She goes, yeah. I said, when you talk on the phone, do you like, does it take hours? She said, what? I said, like, when you talk on the phone, it's something that in my generation, you used to do that for hours with your girlfriend or boyfriend. She goes, I don't talk to them on the phone, I text them. I said, you ain't texting for hours. I said, you got a lot of work to do. She said, what should I do? I said, get excited. When you hear his voice on the phone, that's a thing. That this thing here. No, I can't talk to her. It's a thing you talk on when you can't see somebody. Why? Because we have a desire, whether you like it or not, that we want to be known. We want to be known. C.S. Lewis says this: lovers are always talking to each other about their love. Except as you get older, it's a little different. It gets less. When I was madly in love, I'm going to have to change your name because it gets on videos. And when I was madly in love way back when I was in my early 20s with, let's call her Sally. It's not her name. And I was madly in love with Sally. Long Island, and she said, you know, believe it or not, I used to be a lifeguard swim instructor. Underneath this habit is the body of a Greek god. here's the great thing. I am twice the size of what I was when I was a lifeguard, so you're getting two for the price of one. Okay. So, if Nancy said to me back then, what, because I'm Sally? If Mary said to me, because I was madly in love with her. And when you're madly in love, you'll do anything. All right, so now we know who she is. So if Nancy said to me, Vinny, could you do me a favor? This would be about 5 o'clock in a summer night. She said, could you do me a favor tonight? I said, yeah. Could you go pick my mother up? Oh, yeah. Where is she? In Virginia. So I look at her and I say, okay, you know. I could drive down to Virginia. Take about 6 hours. I drive back and be at work tomorrow. I could do it. So my friend says, you know, what are you doing? I'm going to go pick up Nancy's mother. You want to come? Yeah, where are you going? Virginia. What? So let's suppose Nancy and I got married. 2 years into the marriage, she says to me, we're watching TV, and she says, could you go get me a glass of water? And I'll say, are your legs broken? I gotta walk all the way upstairs to get that water? Does it mean we don't love each other anymore? No, it means that the love shifts and grows and changes. So the one love where it's just kind of like madly in love and high emotional, which is not the friendship, but it's really lovers, are always talking to each other about their love. Friends hardly ever about their friendship. Let's say Mark and I, or Jerry and I said, hey Vinny, let's sit down and talk about our friendship. I'd be like, nah. Lovers are normally face-to-face, absorbed in each other. Friends are side-by-side, absorbed in some common interests. That's a great thing to keep in mind. Is this friendship I have, as one woman said to me, it's leaping from the platonic arena. I said, what the hell does that mean? Well, I wasn't real bright. Leaping from the platonic arena. It means it's moving from friendship to a deeper romantic relationship, okay? So it's friends are side by side, absorbed in some common interest. People just seeking companionship become annoying friends. People seeking companionship almost have no real depth, and it's, I don't want to say it that because none of you do this, but it's like the ones that, oh my God, she's coming this way. Oh God. Sit over here. Don't let her sit there. Why? Because she sucks life out of me. Because she has no friends. She has no friends. She has a lot of companions, but no friends. And that's a danger. It's a danger. We can fall easily into extremes. Either we're best friends or mere acquaintances. Extremes. We lose sight of the degree of vulnerability, which is point number two. Point number one is we all have a desire to be known. Number two is, we also have a need to be vulnerable. We don't like that. That's thing, why? Because when I'm vulnerable, I can get hurt. I don't want to get hurt. I want to protect myself. And every friendship has a degree of risk. That's why it's a level of love. Every action of love has a risk of getting hurt. Everyone. And so you've got to know what you're getting involved in. Know what you're getting involved in when you're talking about friendships, companionships, whatever it may be. So, how is all this lived? All friendships have a connection of love. Without love, the friendship is an obligation. I've been in these, and some of you might have been in these. Friends that are habit. You know, why do I stick with these people? I don't know. I don't even feel comfortable with them, or they're so demanding of me, and then they call up or they text me and say, you want to get together? So, oh yeah. Why don't I say no? I don't want to hurt them. I don't know. I don't know why I'm doing this. I can't seem to break free of it. And that's not friendships. And that's there's something that I have to kind of answer to. I have to look at. And so, like I say, love has all different degrees, but vulnerability is the common connection. Vulnerability is not a comfort zone. It's interesting because I teach for a week in University of Notre Dame. We teach campus ministers the skills of spiritual direction, because they had this big influx of students that wanted spiritual direction. They have a lot of campus. They have like 50 campus ministers or something. So we started to teach them in this very, you know, crammed course of spiritual direction, so they can direct college students. Second year, we go back to follow up, and we ask the question, what is the most common thing you folks experienced this past year in spiritual direction? It was almost unanimous, and it scared me to death. Loneliness. Loneliness. And as one of the campus ministers said, she says, 10,000 students on campus, and loneliness is the common place. Why? What's loneliness? Loneliness is, I don't feel like I'm known. I'm afraid to let somebody really in there because it's scary. It's very scary. I don't want to do that. Vulnerability is not a comfort zone. So friendship is the springboard to these deeper relationships. Elton John had a song out years ago called Friends, and there was a great line in it. Ain't it funny how young lovers start as friends? So friendship is a springboard for love relationships, but it's a springboard to healthy friendships. Okay, I'm going to get spiritual on you for a second. God is not my buddy. God's not my buddy. I hope I might be breaking bad news to you. It's okay at first. Well, Jesus is like a friend of mine. No, he's not. No, he's not. C.S. Lewis has a great line here. Friendship is very rarely the image under which Scripture represents the relationship between God and man. With God, it's not friendship. It's something deeper. So, In John's Gospel, when you know the story, after Jesus rises from the dead, Peter denied him three times. Jesus meets the apostles on the shore. He's cooking breakfast. He's got a fish. He's got a fish on the fire there. And then he asks the apostles, "Guys, got any fish?" If I were one of the apostles, said, "What are you cooking? You got it. You're God. You can get anything you want." So Jesus says, bring the fish over. And he says to Peter, it's a great conversation, do you love me? Peter says, yes, I love you. Do you love me? Yes, come three times. In the Greek, it's different. In the Greek, Jesus Christ says, Peter, do you love me agape? Meaning, in the intensity of your heart. And Peter's response is, yes, Lord, I love you, philia, like a friend. You and I, Jesus, we're buddies. We got common interests, hanging in it together. I take you out on a boat every now and then, we go fishing. Jesus asks him a second time, Peter, do you love me, agape? Peter says, yes, Lord, I love you, philia, as a friend, as a brother. He couldn't get to that next level. The third time, Jesus says, Peter, do you love me, philia, as a brother? And Jesus, and Peter gets annoyed, and he starts swearing. He says, you know everything. You know that I love you as a brother. And then Jesus says, that's right, but you will come to a place of your life when you're stretched out and you cannot go where you once went. Basically, what he's saying is, you're gonna die for me. And at that point, you will know you love me, agape, intimately. That's the relationship that God wants with us. Intimate. God doesn't want to be our friend. Friends are nice. God wants to be intimate and enter into that. Okay, let me wrap this up here. I'm going to give you five things that might help you. Might not. What do I need to do to deepen my friendships? Number one, be willing to be vulnerable. Number two, am I aware of my desire to be known? Some people don't even know that they have a desire to be known. Become confident in who I am and letting people know me. Be confident in who I am. That's part of that, the desire to be known. Number three, don't settle. The biggest problem in relationships, from friendships to intimate one-on-one relationships, don't settle. What does settle mean? Settle is like, well, you know, he's really not a bad person, right? You've been going with this guy for like 4 years. Yeah, he's not a bad guy. Have you ever seen him not drunk? Once, twice. But he's not a bad guy, really. He's not a bad guy. You're settling. What happens, what does it mean to settle? It means I am putting what I need in a friendship aside so I can make somebody else happy. Called codependent behavior. Very common among all of us. We all have done it. We all have done things that we've settled. We've settled, you know, and when you wake up in somebody else's room because you're so drunk and you say, I'm never gonna drink again, I feel so sick. I feel so sick. Don't worry about it. Tonight you're going to have another drink. But no, I settled. You know, and look at the behavior and actions that are life-giving for you. And that's the part of you that wants to be known. Look at the things inside of you, the actions and behaviors that are life-giving. You people are here together. And a common thing, your faith. Your faith. You know, let's say somebody just gets up and says, you know, I really don't believe in this, excuse my language, I don't believe in this religion bullshit. They might be not accepted by you in this room, or we got to work on this one. What do you come here for? The babes. That's not a good enough reason. Well, I'm settling. Settling, you know what's life-giving for you. Faith is probably life-giving for all of you. It's probably life-giving for all of you. make healthy choices. If you make healthy choices, you're not settling. Number four, so I got be willing to be vulnerable, aware of my desire to be known, don't settle, and four, be willing to listen. Do I really hear what someone is saying? Be willing to listen. It's the thing that gets in our way most, more than anything else. We don't really listen to what somebody else is saying. As they're talking, I'm thinking, you know the ones that you could say, there was a woman who used to be cook in our house in Union City, New Jersey. And whatever, no matter what ever happened, you know, oh my God, my stomach's nauseous. Oh, Father, let me tell you, I was throwing up all night. I gotta go to have surgery on my knee. Oh, you know, I have the same thing. I said to her one time, I gotta change her name, but I have to go for it. Oh, she said to me, Father, how's your knee? I said, it's better. It's good. It's going good. You know, my hip, I said, Rose, I didn't ask you about your hip. In fact, I really don't care about your hip. I could joke around like this. So anyway, I said to him one time, I said, you know what? Thank God you weren't around at the time of Jesus' death. She says, why? I said, because Mary would be saying, my son was crucified last night. And you'd be saying, oh, last week my son-in-law. She didn't listen. Now be willing to listen. Listen to somebody else's stories. To really listen to them, to get into their gut. That's important. And number five, so be willing to be vulnerable, aware of what your desire. Don't settle. Be willing to listen. And forgive and seek forgiveness. When I was provincial, I used to say to the guys, if you don't say I'm sorry to somebody every day, you're missing a deeper reflection on yourself. To forgive and seek forgiveness. It's a key thing, especially as Christians, to forgive and seek forgiveness. If we don't do that, friendships become companions. You forgive friends. You allow friends to have mistakes. I'm going to close with this one little thought here. I love this. I saw this on a wall of an elevator. Be kind. For everyone you meet is fighting a battle you know nothing about. Be kind. For everyone you meet is fighting a battle you know nothing about. What's the greatest thing about friendships? Not that I have to know everything about this person, but if the person needs me, I'm there. If the person needs to be known, am I willing to listen? Okay, that's all I got. And any questions? That you probably can even we finish each other's sentences. I can look at her face and I can say something's not right. I know it. I read it. That's that agape type love. Anybody else? Okay, I'm gonna hang around a bit. Some of you have to go to other things. And thanks very much for your attention. I hope it was helpful. And good night. Dear, well, we can stop by.